And is that because of the damage that they can cause when they're combined together?
Retinol, we know, can leave the skin a little bit more sensitive to sunlight, just in the way that it works. And so we'd always recommend not only making sure you use it in combination with your day cream with SPF protection, but also don't use exfoliators or peels that can also potentially damage a slightly more vulnerable skin as you're getting used to the retinol.
Yeah. And on retinol, so you mentioned obviously it's around finding the right concentration and kind of starting slow, kind of building up. So for those who might be kind of beginners to the world of retinol, what kind of concentration levels would you recommend to start with?
Well, actually, Sarah, we've done quite a lot of research in this space with our partners at Manchester University to try and find what we call the sweet spot. Because actually, it's not the case that more and more retinol is a good thing for your skin, because you will hit a point where you'll have tolerance issues that mean you can't really try it and you can't really reach your retinoid potential, as I call it, from your skin. So the concentration that we came to as the sweet spot between tolerance and performance was at 0.3% retinol, which is a really, really great clinically effective concentration, but allows consumers, even who haven't tried retinol before, to get into retinol, ramping up in the way that's suitable for their skin. So listen to your skin, but ramping up so that after 4 to 6 weeks, you can be using it nightly without hopefully any problems of sensitivity.
And so, Mike, I'm really intrigued. So your title is a head of skincare science for Boots. What does that entail, and what would a normal day in the office /lab look like for you?
Well, contrary to popular belief, Sarah, I'm not locked away in the laboratories in Nottingham all the time. I would love to do that. But actually, I'm really lucky because my role is really diverse, because my passion is obviously for the science research. And, you know, as I was this morning, and I was talking to dermatologists and professors talking about our skin science, our research, and really thinking about the future. So it's all future focused, you know, trying to get skin to reveal some more of its secrets to us, so we can then translate that into better solutions, more effective products. So on one side, I'm doing that. And then right at the other end, I'll be talking to journalists and the media and beauty advisors in store about our latest launches and educating in terms of the science and the proof behind our products and technologies. And really, there's everything in between, from talking to our formulators to talking to our brand and marketing colleagues. So, and talking to our other partners across the world who inform and help us develop the next generation best product. So really exciting and diverse role. I feel very privileged in the role that I have.
Sounds incredibly diverse, and I guess you're kind of, as you say, you've got a real eye to the future as well, with kind of all of the different organisations and kind of people that you're dealing with. So in terms of what's coming next in skincare, what would you say might be on the horizon for us in terms of future developments and new products?
So of course I can't reveal too much. It's all very hush hush and secret. But, you know, there are certainly some really big trends that are coming out at the moment. And probably one of the biggest areas is thinking about skin for life, actually. Because what we need to be doing is trying to make sure that skin remains healthy, can do what it needs to do for as long as it possibly can. So I think about it as the skin's health span. It's not about how long we live and how long our skin is there, but it's how long it remains functioning at its best. And really, that's about good preventative skincare. It is. It's about understanding the trajectory that your skin might be on through all the lifestyle choices that we've made. I, for one, was one that went on those package holidays in the sun without any sun protection and are now suffering the consequences of that. But the good news is that whatever your age, whatever your lifestyle choices before, you can make some real positive changes from a prevention point of view to improve things going forward. So I do think prevention, thinking about lifestyle and the impact that lifestyle has on the skin to allow us to make better choices, to allow us our skin to function at its best for longer, is a really exciting area to be working in.
It sounds it, and I can't wait to find out what those top secret projects are that you're kind of working on in the lab. And that bit that you mentioned around lifestyle choices that we could make and how they can make a big difference, what would your top tips be around kind of lifestyle choices we could make to help improve our skincare?
Well, I think, you know, we've all seen this actually during lockdown in terms of the impact of lifestyle and how that affects our skin. And I mean, it's true to say that probably 20% of how our skin responds to what's around us is genetically driven. But there's an awful lot that is related to the choices that we've made, the memory and experiences that our skin has accumulated over time are what drives it to respond in any particular way. And, you know, we all know that stress, for example, psychological stress, has a big impact on our skin. And during this time, I mean, myself, I mean, my skin has suffered. I've been worrying about my family. I've been worrying about my parents, schooling my children, because they're not getting really a very good education at home. All of those things has meant that we have been much more stressed, certainly in the earlier times of lockdown. And that affects our skin's ability to protect itself from the environment. Nutrition has a big impact on skin and its resilience as well. And I know we say it, vegetables and fruit, but the antioxidants that they provide, those antioxidants get into the skin and are part of its natural defenses. So these kinds of things I think are very important, because what we've got to remember is the skin ultimately is about being a barrier. That's its main role. It's a protective barrier, protecting us from the world. And anything that affects that barrier, nutrition, stress, exposure to the environment, going out without your sun protection, that will all mean that the skin is not as resilient to be able to cope with whatever is thrown at it. And it is more likely to suffer from redness or sensitivity or dryness or spots and blemishes.
So when our skin is at its most vulnerable, what are the kind of things that we can do to protect it?
Well, I think we've talked about some of the things that make your skin less resilient and vulnerable. And again, it comes down to having a very consistent skincare routine, as SJ has already said, making sure you do cleanse your skin properly, making sure you use proper SPF protection with 5-star UVA protection daily. Changing your skin routine on a regular basis is probably going to mean your skin can't adapt and get into a pattern itself. So I think good prevention, good cleansing, consistent beauty routine is always what's going to be really helpful in making sure that the barrier, your skin's barrier, remains really consistent. And I think that those lifestyle choices that we make are also very important. So I mentioned stress, I mentioned nutrition, I mentioned making sure that you are protecting your skin when out in the environment. Making sure that you're getting enough sleep is also really important. So one of the areas of research that we're looking at is something called chronobiology. It's a really exciting space, but basically all the cells in our body have little internal clocks, and they tick and they tock, and they function at their best at different times of the day. And so actually, when we don't get enough sleep, when we're jet lagged, for example, those things can basically offset our internal clocks in our skin cells, meaning that they don't do what they need to do as well. So sleep, getting enough of it, is really important. It's scientifically proven. It has an impact on how your skin performs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I guess the skin regenerates at night, doesn't it? So if it doesn't have enough of a window in the evening to regenerate, then I guess that will impact the condition.
Well, absolutely. And it's also related to hormones, stress hormone included in that. So if stress hormone doesn't come on and turn on when it's really needed, which usually is in the early hours of the morning, if your stress levels are up higher, continually through the night, that will absolutely impact the way the skin cells, little internal clocks work and operate. So yes, everything's interconnected. It's interconnected with the brain, it's interconnected with the gut, and of course the skin. It's not, the skin as an organ is not in isolation.
And I think it's an area, like you said, you know, if you think about the gut, it's an area that we're still learning so much about. You know, obviously skin science and skin development has been around for a long time, but you know, the fact that you're already seeing new things that are coming up, it must be quite an exciting area to work in that sense.
I think it is, Sarah, and where we've always struggled is the proof that if you take supplements, for example, and what goes into your gut ends up in your skin, for example. Mm. We've struggled with the diagnostics, with the measurements, actually demonstrating that that is happening. And there's been a lot more advances in technology that allow us, for example, to non-invasively take a tool and measure antioxidants in the skin that have come from your diet, for example, in a way that we couldn't do before. So I think that's about science and the progression that we're making to really be able to measure and diagnose these things much better than we've ever done before.
And SJ, have you got any tips around kind of diet or lifestyle? You mentioned obviously that you run a lot. Do you see that that has an impact on your skin and kind of how you feel?
I mean, definitely running for me, it does impact how I feel. I'm a much nicer person if I've been for a run. You know, I always make sure, like I said, I always have SPF on my face and backs of my hands as well. And also, I think it is, you know, it's so important what Mike was saying about nutrition and your skin. You know, I'm no scientist, but I know that when I have those periods of time where perhaps my weakness is chocolate and sugar, that when I indulge too much in that, lo and behold, my skin doesn't look as good. So, you know, none of us are saints. We can't all, you know, not be indulging in things that we like all the time, because, you know, life is for living. But I think we all know that in moderation, you know, wearing SPF, hopefully drinking not too much, smoking not at all, if you can do that, you know, you're going to be in a better place inside and out. But we can all only try our best on that one.
Yeah, definitely. I think we've all got to have little treats, haven't we? Just stay sane.
I think, Sarah, I think it's worth mentioning that exercise, I run as well, actually. Mm-hmm. And I find that there's an indirect benefit from running and exercise just simply through mental health. Mm-hmm. And I think exercise does obviously do that. I mean, it improves our mental health. That's been very important for me during lockdown, to be able just to escape into the Peak District, which is where I live.
I guess, Mike, could you just tell us a little bit more about the science behind skin and why we're all different?
What a question, Sarah. Yes. I mean, fundamentally, in terms of what skin is made of, the stuff in skin, it's pretty much the same, whatever our skin type, whatever our gender, whatever our ethnicity. But the differences are about how we respond and how our skin responds to everything around us. And my rule of thumb is that probably 20% of skin and the different responses that we all have to the environment is genetics driven. And then the rest of it is actually due to the experiences and memory that have been accumulated over time. And that's really important. I mean, that's how we respond to our everything around us as people, isn't it? It's kind of a accumulation of all our experiences and memories of what happened before. And that kind of informs how we're going to behave in any particular situation. Our skin is no different. And it might surprise people to know that your skin does have memory. It remembers. It remembers that you went out into the sun without sun protection those 10 years ago. It remembers all these things, unfortunately. But what that does is it makes us very individual and unique. That's just the way it is. You know, our skin is made up of all those exposures that we've had, as well as the genetics as well. And that leads us to very unique and individual needs. And what's interesting, of course, is that the industry has created products that are suitable for everybody. That's kind of suitable for all. But within that, there's loads of compromises, of course. So a product and technology might work very well for one person, but for another, it might not. because of all sorts of different reasons. And I think what we're getting to and what the need is for this hyper-personalization. And actually, by understanding everybody's individual needs and skin, we will get to, as we're starting to, the individual needs and develop a product and technology absolutely suited to you and all the experiences and memory that you have in your skin. And I think that's really exciting.
And how far away do you think something like that is?
I think that we're not too far off that. And I think we're going to take steps towards it. But, you know, for some areas, for example, there are people have their own individual. So they have cells in there. Of course, we'll have cells in our skin. But those cells have almost a unique blueprint that allows them to interact with certain technologies better than others, for example. So you can imagine in the world of retinol, for example, is the fact that some people respond really quickly to retinol and others take a lot longer, is that related to the fact that actually they don't have as many of these little connections on their cells for the retinol? Ah, who knows? The research hasn't found that out yet. That's what the kind of things that we need to start looking at, and we are, to try and really, really uncover this world of hyper-personalization. So really exciting space, and it's all to go at.
Gosh, it really is. It's been fascinating to talk to you both today and kind of learn more about skincare from kind of both of your different worlds, and, you know, the products that we should all have in our routine, some new ones in there for me, definitely. And yeah, I just want to say thank you so much for joining us today. It's been great to chat to you both.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah.